My guest tonight is one of the world's most sought-after and celebrated actors of his generation. For his 27-year career, David Tennant has created memorable characters over a diverse and expansive array of film, television, and stage roles. After graduating from the Royal Scottish Academy of Music and Drama, he launched his career. Yes, let's hear it for the Scots. Who's here? He launched his career in his native Scotland, and it was the TV series Taken Over the Asylum that got him to London, where he won over critics and audiences alike in the Joe Orton play, What the Butler Saw, at the National. At age 25, he joined the Royal Shakespeare Company, appearing as, yes, the RSC, appearing as Touchstone in As You Like It, followed by The Comedy of Errors, The Rivals, Romeo and Juliet, and A Midsummer Night's Dream. Over the years, he has honed his craft on stage in such productions as The Herbal Bed, The Glass Menagerie, Look Back in Anger, Lobby Hero, The Pillow Man, and for the RSC, he electrified audiences as Hamlet, winning a Critics' Choice Award for Best Shakespearean Performance, which was subsequently filmed for the BBC. He rocked the world as the 10th Doctor on the phenomenon known as Doctor Who. For his performance, he has won every conceivable award, including two BAFTAs. He appeared in the J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter series as Barty Crouch Jr. Yes, you're Harry Potter? And Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire. He is also known to legions of fans for his role of Detective Alec Hardy on the critically acclaimed, yes, BBC crime series Broadchurch, which begins filming its third season this summer. Get ready, right? This past November, he starred as the evil Dr. Zebediah Kilgrave, otherwise known as the Purple Man, opposite Krystin Ritter in the Netflix Marvel series Jessica Jones. And now he is making his U.S. stage debut as Richard II as part of the Royal Shakespeare Company's King and Country, Shakespeare's Great Cycle of Kings at BAM. Please welcome David Tennant. Wow.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Wow. Thanks very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Woo. I'm rather overwhelmed. That was the most well-researched and thorough introduction I've ever had.
No mistakes, right?
I don't think so.
Good.
Well,
none.
Well, we'll pick that later.
Well, listen, first off, congratulations on making your U.S. stage debut at BAM.
Yes.
How does it feel?
Well, I'm just glad to get through it. You know what I mean? Just glad to get from the start to the finish without forgetting anything or falling over, basically, which has been my career. It's certainly made very comfortable and pleasant by being in the BAM Harvey Theater, which is a masterpiece of an auditorium. I love it there.
Yeah.
I want to do everything there from now on. I mean, obviously, it's a production we've done previously. We've done it in London, we've done it in Stratford-on-Avon, so it's familiar from that point of view. But there's definitely a frisson about coming to New York, which is, after, you know, alongside London, is the town for theatre, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's I feel alarming. Usually my 26-year career makes me sound ancient. it does feel a bit remiss that it's taken me 26 years to get here.
Totally, right?
I don't quite know what went wrong. But I'm thrilled to finally have made it.
Perfect. Your performance as Richard II is perfection, as is the production. Was this a role... Well, some of you saw it, right? Totally. Was this role always on your bucket list to play?
Yes, it was. Seeing as we're talking dates, would it have been? I went to drama school in 1988. I saw Derek Jacobi touring Richard II round Scotland. He came to the Glasgow Theatre Royal when we were in first or second year. So we're talking 88, 89. And he came to the Glasgow Theatre Royal. We went as a little sort of group from drama school. And I'd never seen Richard II. I'd never read Richard II. I would have been, 17, 18. And I just thought, what a fantastic play and what a fantastic part. And I sort of had it tucked away as an ambition ever since then.
Yeah.
We all went around to stage door and got him to sign our programs. I told him this years later when we worked together. He was very unimpressed. I guess it happens to him a lot. But it stayed with me. It was very formative, and it's just a great, you know, it's such an interesting part because he's such a twat. and yet, by sort of somewhere around the interval, Shakespeare, just by a sleight of hand, just makes you start feeling for him and just completely reverses the whole sympathies of the audience. He was quite a good writer. So it's such a clever bit of writing, and it's such a great part. And it was always one I had on the, as you say, on the bucket list. Yeah.
How did this production originally come about?
Gregory Jordan and I had, as you mentioned, we've done a few shows together, and every now and again we'd had that conversation about what, you know. I said, so Greg, what are you thinking? What's coming up? What are the plays that you've still got to do? And he kind of goes, what are the plays you might be interested in doing? And we discussed several possibilities, and Richard II was one that, as he took over artistic directorship of the Royal Shakespeare Company, he'd been there for years as one of its principal associates, or the principal associate, but as he took over the company, it was the play that he wanted to start his tenure with. So he just came to me and said, look, I know you wanted to do the play. In about 2 years' time, it'll be my first production as the boss. I thought, I can't say no to that. What a great opportunity. So it was just one of those ones that was a lovely meeting of the moment.
Yeah. I love the look of the show also. You and I started talking about
it's
this backstage.
Yeah.
Like those triptych Wilton.
Yes. Well, yes. The Wilton triptych, yeah. which we absolutely steal from. There's a point where there are singers go off stage and come back on in a kind of royal blue robe. And on the other side of the stage, you have some of the characters kind of all looking up in this prayer formation, which is Richard used to take into battle with him. This painting, which on three panels, a triptych, and he would unfold it on apparently close to the battlefield and pray to it. So we've tried to recreate that on stage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what a great company of actors you get to work with.
Yeah. Yeah, not too shabby. it's very exciting. It really is. When the RSC really works is when you have actors like this who can all just do it, you know, and you just kind of go, ooh, 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 right, here we go. And every night you're kind of, you just have to listen to everyone else. It's exciting every night.
You know, you're working with one of the most sought after directors and one of the finest directors in Gregory Doran, who is also the artistic director of the RSC. What makes him such a wonderful director?
Well, Shakespeare is his absolute passion. It's his raison d'être. It's what got him into the theater, and he's a master of it. He's a genius about it. I mean, the amount of sort of information he retains, and that's to do with the history of the plays, the understanding of the plays, the production history of the plays, in terms of our plays, the history itself. He's all over all of it. So to be in a rehearsal room with him working on a Shakespeare play is where he needs to be. So you know that you've got that extraordinary resource with you the whole time. But at the same time, he's not prescriptive with it. So although he understands these plays backwards, and he understands Shakespeare backwards, and he knows how it works, he understands all the heritage that comes with them, the line of these productions stretching way back. He'll rattle off dates and productions and, oh, when John Barton did it, this happened. When John Slinger did it, this happened. He knows a lot about when Tony Sher did it because they are partners. So he's got all this. He's got this sort of massive kind of wealth of knowledge. he brings all that to bear, and yet he's also then interested in what's new and what's never been done before, and he's so it's absolutely creative at all times,
yeah.
But backed up with this brilliance and this passion. He speaks about Shakespeare, and it brings tears to your eyes. It brings tears to his eyes as well. He cries at the drop of a hat. but it's moving. You know, he's so engaged with this material, and he's the only person you would want to be in a rehearsal room with.
Yeah, because you first did Richard in 2013, 2014.
Yeah.
So now revisiting him this time, has he changed for you, your Richard?
I'm inevitably, but I'm also, I think I'm a bit too close to it to entirely know. And of course we revived it just at the very end of last year for the Barbican in London for a sort of quick kind of brush down before we brought it here. And we have significant cast changes. We have a new Bolingbroke, a new John of Gaunt, a new Queen, a new O'Merrill. So all those characters that have a lot of interaction with Richard, that inevitably changes what you do and how you do it. Scenes just come alive in different ways, in different directions. That's really all of Richard's central relationships, apart from, I suppose, York, played by the magnificent Oliver Ford Davis. Everyone else really around me has changed. So inevitably that's going to change how you do it. But I can't tell. I'm too sort of in it at the moment to really know what that means.
Got it, sure. Gregory Doran said of your Shakespeare, with David, somehow the lines don't sound like 400-year-old lines. How do you manage that? We have a lot of actors in the house here tonight who wrestle with the language of Shakespeare.
I do too. I mean, it's quite archaic. It's difficult. You first read it and go, what the fuck does that mean? even the more you do it, you still come across a word. You think, what is that word? That's not a word. that's part of the process, and that's something that Greg specifically does, and many directors have different versions of this. But the first 2 weeks of rehearsals with Hamlet, which is a longer play, I think it was half the rehearsal process. We just sat around a table, and we read. You weren't even allowed to read your own speeches. That's the rule. So the entire company is involved, and that's good. That's an important part of the process of building a company, I think, as well. Because Shakespeare plays, they have many actors in them, but they are, by definition, quite hierarchical, in as much as not everyone has as much to do as everyone else. So there's a really important process, I think, of everyone just sitting together in a room for weeks. And it can be a bit head-banging, actually, because you're being meticulous, and you're going through the text, and you're taking it line by line. So what happens is you start at the start of the play, and you start with whoever's, you pick a point on the table, and that actor reads the first speech, whatever it might be. If it's your part, you pass it on to the next person. So with Richard II, it's Richard opens the play, Old John of Gaunt, Time Honored Lancaster, and the first actor will read that, and we'll then have to translate it into a modern idiom. We'll then have to say exactly what it means. And everyone around the table is kind of scrupulous about that. So if anyone fudges something, you go, no, hang on, what exactly does that mean? And of course that ends up, that unpacks the meaning, which is the first and most important thing that you require. But discussions go off in different directions, that'll lead to discussions in a play like this about the history of the moment, or about the psychology of the characters, or about how one character is, whether they're lying or not. So you're unpacking the whole play slowly, methodically, and by the end of that process, everyone in that room understands every line. And then you're allowed to read your own part. And then you're going, hang on, we've only got 2 weeks left. but what it does, and it can be, it can be a slog, that process. But it's hugely empowering. It's empowering for the company. And it's empowering, because you're not allowed to read your own part, and you're not allowed to comment on your own part, it means you just have to sit there and let other people unpack the meaning of your lines, which at times can be frustrating, because you want to go, that's not what it means, come on! But because you're forced to shut up, you kind of you can go through a process of going, inside your head you're going, that's not what it means, and then it gets debated for a while and you go, oh, maybe that is what it means. Or maybe that's more interesting because maybe that it just sets the synapses firing, and it's just a way of tearing it all apart so you can put it back together again. Of course it's difficult. It's hard to understand. That's why Shakespeare works in performance in a way that it doesn't work in a classroom necessarily, unless you've got the best English teacher. Yeah. And they are rarer than hen's teeth, and they are people who need to be celebrated and paid more money than they are. But they're rare, you know, and it's frustrating that so many people's first experience of Shakespeare is sitting in a classroom going, you know, hence home, you idle creatures, get you home. And standing up in class and reading a bit in some dull monotone, that's going to kill it. It because it's hard to understand, it needs to be translated. It needs to be transmitted through performance. That's when it comes alive. Because Shakespeare made words up as well. So it's, you know, there are words in Shakespeare that don't mean anything beyond a kind of muscular sound that they make in that moment. That works in performance. That doesn't work in a classroom when you're trying to work out the entomology of the noun. It's dead. It's got to just fire and live.
Because you all seem like you're on the same page, and I guess when you watch
all
the performance.
Well, that process, I think, gets everyone, helps to get everyone there. Yeah.
Did Gregory come up with that?
What he does. It's what he's done on every Shakespeare play that I've worked with him on. And I'm pretty sure he's going to stick with it because I think it pays dividends. But I'm sure it's something he's inherited and adapted from other processes he's seen. I don't know the origin of it, but
I'll have to ask him.
You should.
Next time over cheese.
Yeah. Yeah.
I read where you said I feel safer in theater. But then there's the process of actually doing theater.
Yeah.
Are you still scared?
Terrified. Every single time. I do wonder. Yes. It's weird. This has been. Because. Sorry. Tell you what, I'll use sentences. This has been quite an interesting process because we're not on every night.
Yeah.
Because the plays are in rep, because there's a cycle of these four history plays, and I'm only in one of them. So I'm doing two, maybe three shows a week. So you never get into that routine of it, which means you're always a little bit on edge. Every night you're going, what is that bit? There's a bit of that going on all the time. And it means that there's a bit of a Bunsen burner under you the whole time. And that just makes everything a little bit more alive, which means, it means I've been thinking a lot about the extremes of being on stage. And the truth of it seems to be that when it's good, there's sort of nothing like it. When you're in that moment and the audience is with you and you're telling that story and it's alive and it's happening and you're inventing stuff and it feels like it's never happened before, there is nothing better than it. It's just like flying. It's great. When it's bad, it's awful. When you start getting those demons in your head going, you don't know the next line, you're going to have to stop. You're going to have to tell everyone. You're going to have to go, sorry, thank you for coming to the BAM Harvey Theater. But now you're going to have to go home. Because I don't know what I've got to say next. I've just shat myself. the extremes of it are extraordinary, which is why, of course, I think you keep going back to it because it's like a roller coaster, and that's kind of addictive. But every first night, I think, why am I doing this? This is horrible. Nothing about this is pleasant. I'm standing backstage about to sort of torture myself. Then, of course, when it works and it happens, and you think, this is how to tell stories. This is exciting. And it's the same experience when I'm in an audience. Bad theater is like having things poked under your fingernail. And you're sitting in an uncomfortable seat, and you've paid $15 for a drink and you're and you hate the fact that you bought a program and wasted money because you hate these actors. Why? I don't care that they've been in The Good Wife. I hate them. And I could have been at home. I could have been on the PlayStation. What am I doing here? But when it's good, yeah, it's more exciting than anything else. And I think the extremes of theatre are the same if you're in an audience or if you're in it. None of that brings me to any conclusion. It's just an observation.
It's a great one.
I think the act of doing a show intermittently has made it has brought it home to me all the more keenly. So it depends, you know, if I have a good night, I come up thinking, what's next? Come on, back on stage. If I have a bad night, thinking, never doing that again. Funny, isn't it?
The life of an actor.
Yeah.
But you always come back for more.
So far.
Well, I want to go back to the beginning. Where did your love for performing begin, and what were your earliest creative outlets?
Oh, making stories up in the back garden, I think. You know, running around, my parents used to always report tales of me running around the back garden talking to myself, but I wasn't talking to myself. I was making up stories, and they would be about whatever, you know. I grew up watching Doctor Who, so I would make up Doctor Who stories in the back garden, and I would run around. I'd be all the characters in a Superman show in my head. You know, that was my earliest creative. That may not be what you were actually asking about.
It was actually.
That was just what I did. I just ran around to talk to myself.
What was the defining moment for you when you said, I want to be an actor? Were you like three?
Oh, I think I was three. Yeah. And I think it comes from watching Doctor Who, which is, you know, absurdly prescient. But I know I was three because it was watching. Do I assume everyone knows what I'm talking about with Doctor Who? Do I have to explain? Okay. I don't know, you know. Not everyone does. It's not compulsory. Yes, it is. It is. It's compulsory. No, I remember watching John Pertwee regenerate into Tom Baker. Now, I remember seeing it happen. And I can check the dates. I can only have been three. Now, if there was a repeat, maybe I was four. But I'm still weirdly young. And now, having children at that age, I'm going, is stuff like that going on in your head now? It's amazing to think that I had such a presumptuous thought, but obviously it was a sort of random thought that matured. But it was tenacious. I remember watching John Pertwee turn into Tom Baker, and quizzing my parents about it, and them explaining that they were actors telling a story, and I got that. I remember getting that, and not having an issue about. That people often say children have a problem with fantasy and reality. I don't think they do. I think children absolutely get it. I think children just are more fluid with the way they interpret that. And I think that's rather a charming thing that we sort of lose, perhaps, as we grow up and get cynical. But I remember understanding that was a job I could do and thinking, well, I'll do that then. it seemed like a no-brainer. Yeah. Which wasn't a phrase I used at the time.
Sure.
And yes, as I grew up, that idea matured alongside me.
Yeah. I believe it's the people we meet when we are young that see something special in us that have the biggest impact on us with shaping us as people. Tell me about two of your earliest mentors, your English language teacher, Moira Robertson.
Oh, yeah.
And actress Edith MacArthur.
Wow, you have researched this stuff. This is amazing. My dad used to do a little bit of work in television. He was a minister in the Church of Scotland. And he did stuff in local television in Scotland, little sort of thought for the day stuff, where he'd get like 5 minutes and he'd go, hello, let me tell you about blah. And he'd do a little thing. It was called Late Call. It was on late at night. And anyone who grew up in Scotland would remember it. It was just a little thing that was on local television. And he used to do that. And then he graduated to doing a show called That's the Spirit, which was like a little religious affairs magazine program. because of that, he was a bit in at Scottish television. And he got to know through that, I think that was the link, how he got to know Edith. Edith MacArthur was in the Scottish soap opera at the time called Take the High Road. It's so funny, I'm in New York talking about Take the High Road. Oh, if people from Paisley could see this. Well, maybe they will.
They will.
Edith MacArthur was the kind of grand dame of Take the High Road. She was, what would the equivalent be? Sort of Joan Collins in Dynasty, you know.
Sure.
She was quite a big deal. And she also had a long and illustrious theater career and doing all sorts of things. She was in a famous production of Sunset Song that Scottish Television did. Anyway, Edith was quite, and my dad got to know her. And he brought her along to a school play called Gypsum's Journey. I was 9, 10? And Edith came to see it as the sort of special guest. She came to our school and she watched this production that our music teacher, Alan McLean, had written. And I played Gypsum. I played this goblin who comes to the mortal world in green tights and sort of a hat with pointed ears stapled onto the side of it. It was an operetta. We sang. In the goblin world, everything was sung. And then when we went to the mortal world, we had breaks from the singing, just as well. Anyway, Edith came to see it and sort of was obviously fated as the celebrity guest. And Edith just became someone that I was sort of in touch with. And then as I grew up and I graduated from drama school, we worked together. We were in a production of Hay Fever together, the Noel Coward play, and she played Judith Bliss. And she was a big Scottish star. And then we did Long Day's Journey Into Night together, and I played her son, and she was Mary Tyrone. And she was spellbinding. Wonderful to work with. And so Edith became a sort of, I don't know, what would you describe? So it's certainly, I suppose, a mentor, certainly
Because she told your parents that you're going to work together or something.
I believe she did. Yeah. She said, he'll play my son one day. And then I did twice.
And she told you that during the Goblin play.
Yeah, yeah. Thank goodness she was right. It was a real honor. And a really magnificent actress. Yeah. She's not so well these days and doesn't work anymore, but it's a loss to the theatre.
Sure.
She's still going strong, and I feel like I owe a lot to Edith, yeah.
And then your English language teacher, who sort of set you on your path right away, didn't she?
Well, that was one of those experiences where there's a teacher that makes things come alive.
Yeah.
And that's what Mrs. Robertson, I can't call her Moira, that's... I'd get slapped. That's what she did. Literature in general and I guess plays specifically, just they felt like things that were accessible and fascinating. And I remember we studied Death of a Salesman. I just remember, for the first time studying a play and it really coming alive.
How old were you in her class? Do you remember?
I'd have been 13, 14. Probably maybe for a couple of years, I think, 14, 15, 16, something like that.
But we all remember those teachers that you sat there and they gave you something. You were like, wow, I can work on this. I can, they set something, set something off in you.
Yeah, just that sense of words sort of catching fire in your head. It's interesting, we used a lot of American literature. It was Arthur Miller, it was Harper Lee, it was J.D. Salinger. It was also George Orwell, and it was also, of course, Shakespeare. But I remember being very fired up by those texts in particular.
You know, one of your first big breaks was the TV series Taken Over the Asylum.
Yeah.
Where you played, someone, go ahead.
Yeah.
You can see all this stuff. It's all on YouTube. You can buy DVDs of
You
this
can
stuff.
buy a DVD, obviously.
That's it.
As many members of the acting profession are here, we need our residuals. So,
yes. Amen on that. That changed everything for you, didn't it?
It did, actually. It did. It was the first sort of big chunk of telly I'd done, So that gave me an opportunity to move to London and you know, because there's an acting world in Scotland. There still is, and it waxes and wanes depending on how many productions are in town.
Yeah.
Basically, but and I had a I worked in the theatres there and loved it. But I sort of Taken Over the Asylum was made in Scotland but broadcast nationally, and it won a BAFTA as Best Drama of the Year, and it gave me an opportunity to sort of pack up my Ford Fiesta and drive to London and see if there was there was anything to be had in the big city.
Was that a big defining moment for you?
Yeah, it was scary. Packing up my little car and driving 400 miles and lodging with a friend who's still a very dear friend of mine, Arabella Weir, who played a role in Taken Over the Asylum, and she needed a lodger. And I thought, well, this is it, right? I'll go down. I'll move into Ari's front room, and we'll see what happens. And
you got an agent?
I got an agent. Yeah. I came down. I got an agent in London, big posh agent, and then I got a job at the Young Vic Theatre. Yeah. And I thought, oh, that's it. I've got a job in London now, playing with the big boys. It was playing a man from Paisley, but you know, it was. So the field was limited.
Totally.
But yeah.
Well, the first thing I saw you in was when I was on a trip to London where you did the Joe Wharton play, The Butler Saw.
Right.
Yep. At the National.
Right.
Playing the role of Nick. And I was like, who is that?
Right.
And I said, he's going to be a big star.
Oh, well, thank you.
I'm really good about picking. I was like, wow, you were so interesting. I love Joe Wharton plays.
Yeah.
And I love what you did in that show.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
What do you remember about that experience and what that did for your career?
Lots of things. I was working at the National Theatre of Great Britain, which was what I remember getting, going up for it and thinking, I've got an audition at the National. And then getting the part was like, it was a huge moment. It felt like I'd been kind of accepted and that I got to play on at this theatre, you know, where I'd gone to see things and marveled and I was going to be in a play with Richard Wilson, who at the time was, I think, the most famous man in the country. He did a sitcom, and he was, you know, he was like, who would the equivalent be? I was going to say Bill Cosby. No, don't use that. There are very few similarities between Richard and Bill Cosby, allegedly. He was a massive star, you know, but also from Greenock, just down the road. So that was exciting, and this fantastic play, and it was just it was huge for me. It was enormous that I'd got this job, and I loved it. I just had a
great director,
fantastic time. A great director, yeah. Phyllida Lloyd. Whatever happened to her?
Little show called Mamma Mia, right?
Oh, that was it, yes.
But great cast. I was going back through the program and stuff, but great director, great cast.
Yeah.
But critics and audiences like that really put you on the map in London.
I guess so, yeah. I don't know. It's hard to know what...
What moves you to the next.
When you're in the middle of it. It's hard to... Nothing feels like it changes your life because you're just sort of chugging on through it, you know. I mean, it was hugely exciting for me.
Yeah.
But it's very hard to look at that objectively and know what leads to the next thing, you know.
Well, after that, you first joined the RSC in 1996 when you were like 25.
20 years ago.
You were 25.
I'm only 25 now. It's true, though. I keep having this conversation with my wife. I say, I can still play early 20s. And she stopped agreeing with me. I don't know what went wrong.
How did that happen for you? That's a big step, too.
Well, that was, I suppose, I don't really know. I had an audition. And it was one of those RSC seasons where... that you had to be in more than one play. So they would do these auditions where you'd go. They used to have a space at the Barbican in London, and they had offices, and you'd sort of go and you'd kind of be there for a day, and you'd go down different corridors, because there'd be like, I don't know how many plays there were in a season, 9, 12 plays in a season. So there'd be all these directors in little rooms, and you'd get led up and down, and you'd meet all sorts of different directors for all sorts of different plays, and they were all kind of juggling. Because they would sort of barter with each other. And they'd go, well, I really want I really want Joe Fiennes to play Troilus. He was in that season. Will you have him as Silvius so that I can get in As You Like It? And there was a bit of that. I'm sure that didn't happen with Joe. They all wanted Joe. Of course they did. You'd meet them all, and you'd read for all sorts of different plays, and then they'd go away and sort of trade you all off until they could get a company together that cross cast through all these different plays. So I did one of those days, and I met Michael Attenborough for Herbal Bed. I met Stephen Pinlott, dearly departed, for As You Like It. And I met Howard Davis for a play called General from America. And I played Alexander Hamilton in that. And I didn't sing, which was my first mistake. it was a play about Benedict Arnold, which was written by an American. Very American play about a very American subject. The audience of Stratford didn't really get it. But it was a great piece by Richard Nelson. I met other directors for other plays as well, which of course I've forgotten about now, because I just remember the ones that gave me the job. It was 20 years ago. And I played Touchstone in As You Like It.
But you went in for Orlando. You wanted the romantic lead, didn't you?
I did. How wrong I was. I did. I read for Orlando, which is a really boring part. Yeah. I'm really glad I didn't get it. Or it would have been boring if I did it. There are actors who could make something of it. Yeah. I'm sure many of you are in this room. I would have been terrible. I've never been very good at the kind of straightforward parts. I need to play the sort of quirky, weird person. I'm much better at them. I 20 years ago, what age was I? Young. I obviously thought that's where I should be playing romantic leads, but that never really worked out. And I got offered Touchstone and thought, what? Why have they offered me Touchstone? I don't even know if I read for Touchstone.
You were bartered.
I was bartered. I think the part that got me, it was Jack Lane in The Herbal Bed.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes, lots of people here are actors, right? Yeah. So sometimes you have those auditions and you're going to go, oh, I just nailed it right there. It's really rare. But you kind of go in and you go, oh, I just got this. And I was sight reading it as well. It was one of those ones that just, you kind of go, oh, I just got that part. I think that's the one that got me. And I think Michael Attenborough had to probably go in and bat for me to get with the other parts. I don't know. One day I'll ask him. That's probably why I got Touchstone, because Touchstone's more of a kind of Jack Lane part than it is a... Then certainly Orlando would have been. So, yeah.
You'd worked on a lot of comedic roles during those seasons, right?
I guess so. Certainly Jack Lane was, and Touchstone hopefully is. Alexander Hamilton wasn't.
No. But the Rivals, Comedy of Errors.
But they were later, but yes, I suppose. They were. Although in that same that later season, I also did Romeo, which I finally got to do my romantic lead. I was nearly too old. And didn't really play it like a romantic lead, because I don't think I'm very good at them just as well.
Well, you have this incredibly expansive career on film, stage, and TV. Let's talk about some of your highlights.
Okay? This is fun. It's like Big Brother.
This is your life.
Here are your best bits.
Here are your best bits.
I want to see clips.
When we move to the big house, when we go to the other house with SAG-AFTRA Foundation, we have the black box.
When we edit this together, we'll put the clips in later. It'll be fine.
They will be. You are known to millions of fans around the globe for your portrayal of the 10th Doctor on the worldwide sensation Doctor Who.
Wow.
As you look back, what is it like being a part of pop culture and this whole phenomenon?
It's amazing. It's amazing to be associated with something that people love so much. It's fantastic. It's such a privilege. It really is. Because I grew up loving that show, and then it went away. You know, you could argue that I became an actor because I fell in love with Doctor Who. And then it went away. So then by then I was wanting to be an actor because I wanted to play Hamlet, and I wanted to play Richard II, and I wanted to do all that. And then Doctor Who came back, and then I got offered the part. And it was all a bit kind of sort of mad, but wonderful, wonderful to be part of something, and to be part of it, something when it was thriving and when it was being looked after by the geniuses that look after it now. I mean, Russell T. Davis, you know, I'd do anything. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Just get what television needs to be. One of the greatest television writers of all time. He understands it. He has his own vision. It's so clear. It's so fun. It's so inventive. And to be gifted that, and to be gifted Russell's take on that, that's just one of the luckiest things that will ever happen to me. And it's a lovely thing to be associated with because people love it. And people of all generations love it. And even people that don't know it love it. People who've never seen the show know they're supposed to love it. Yeah. So they just love it. It's impossible to hate Doctor Who. It's full of sort of love, and it's expansive, and it's embracing the universe, quite literally. So it's a lovely show to be associated with, and to be associated with it so sort of centrally I often say the first line of my obituary has been written, but what a first line! That's great!
Because how did you land the role? You were working with Russell and Julie Gardner on Casanova, right?
That's right. Russell.
Yep, yes. Let's hear Casanova.
Thank you. Russell, the writer, executive producer, Julie Gardner, the executive producer extraordinaire, were both working on this Casanova, which they'd been working on and off for years, and it had sort of died, and they went off and put Doctor Who on, and then suddenly they were making Casanova as well. It kind of came back, and they had to look after that at the same time as giving rebirth to Doctor Who, which was quite a big job. So I got to know them through that, and they got to know me, and I suppose, although I was completely unaware of it at the time, that was a kind of extended audition for Doctor Who, yeah.
Because you had a couple of weeks of indecision before you said yes to them. They offered it to you, and then you went away, right?
Yes, because Russell said on the night they offered it to me, and I laughed, and he said, because he was from a writing point of view, he had a similar journey to me. He grew up loving Doctor Who and wanting to write those type of stories, and suddenly he was in a world where that's what he was doing. So he knew the process that you sort of had to go through. When you get offered something that you've sort of fantasized about, but never in a very real way, and suddenly someone goes, this can be your life after all. And you have to kind of, at first you're going to go, that's amazing, and then you're going to go, oh, hang on. What if this isn't what I need it to be? Or what if I break it? What if I break my memories and my dreams and my 8-year-old self's hopes? What if I'm not very good at it? Or what if it isn't much fun? Or you know, the transition of something being a dream to an actual everyday reality is quite an odd one. And also, the big thing as well, at that time, the show hadn't even transmitted yet. So it might have not worked. At which point, I'd have been saying yes to being the guy that turns up at the end of episode 13, the final episode. So I would have played the Doctor for 32 seconds. Which would still have been cool.
That's great.
But it might not have been quite the same. But, it may not have changed my life in the way that it did, and it might have always felt like a bit of a missed opportunity, I suppose. But anyway, it didn't work out that way. So
because where were you in your career at the time when you were offered this?
I was sort of, I was Casanova, which I was shooting at the time, or we'd just finished shooting, was the first time I'd played a big stonking lead part on the TV. And that had felt like a big step forward.
Yeah.
I'd been doing really nice parts in really nice shows, a couple in a row. So I'd sort of was on a bit of a roll, but it felt like, oh right, I'm sort of in this quite a lot now. I'm sort of in every day, and I've got to kind of step up a bit. So I was also aware that taking on something like Doctor Who would lose a certain amount of anonymity, and that was going to be a new phase of life. Even if it was short-lived, even if it was something that didn't work, just because of the sort of attention that Doctor Who gets, particularly in the UK, I would always be sort of associated with that. And so that's part of the decision that you had to make as well. that you're kind of surrendering a bit of your life a little to an extent. And that was part of the reason why I kind of went, is this the right thing to do, actually? Will this just not be quite what I hope? And then you sort of hum and haw for a little bit, and then you wake up one day and go, yeah, but I'm not going to let someone else do it. That would be weirder. So it was a sort of, it was another no-brainer. But you just kind of have to wonder if, you know, it took a bit of a moment, and then it was great.
Do you remember your first day on the set?
I do, yes. I do remember my first day on the set. It started with a photo shoot, because they were very keen that we should, because there's all the whole big thing about what's the doctor going to wear. That gets built up and whipped up. So we'd figured out this costume, and then of course they were terrified that paparazzis would shoot us on the street. So I got put in the costume, and myself and Billy Piper stood in front of a TARDIS and had our photographs taken. That was the first thing we did. Then I got out of that costume and put some pajamas on, so they could have waited. I remember it vividly, because there's so much good. You're thinking, well, this is the next goodness knows how many years of my life. There's going to be a lot of attention on this. People are going to. This is going to elicit more scrutiny than anything you've ever done before. You want to make people proud. You want to be okay. You don't want to break it. Because by then the show had transmitted and had been a massive success, and the BBC were really pleased with it, and they were very keen that their new baby didn't get spoiled. So it's quite hard to kind of swallow that pressure down and just do your job and just learn the lines and just get on with it, which of course is ultimately what it has to turn into. It has to turn into a case of, you know, shoot the master, shoot the reverses, move on to the next scene, because it's still a TV show that has a kind of conveyor belt that has to keep moving. So all that stuff sort of roaring in your head as you just try and kind of do the scene. And it was with Penelope Wilton as well, who's just this extraordinary, brilliant actress that I was in awe of, and Billy Piper, who'd been this huge, famous pop star, who was now this brilliant actress. She just sort of turned from a pop star into a brilliant actress. You know, that's not supposed to happen. That's supposed to be much more difficult. You're supposed to be there and try to do that, and everyone goes, yeah, you're rubbish, and you go back to doing that. And then you get a drug problem and you die in squalor, and that... But somehow Billy just gone, yeah, I'll do that. And everyone went, yeah, you will. So there was all, you know... And suddenly you're kind of you're sort of dropped into the middle of this thing that's all working really well, and it's going to go, don't break it. So all that was going on, and it was the scene, for anyone who knows it. It was the scene at the end of the Christmas Invasion episode. We've just been on the. Anyone who doesn't know it, this is going to sound like gibberish. We've been on the Sycorax spaceship. We get beamed back down to Earth.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're in a sort of car park, and Harriet Jones, the Prime Minister, yes, we know who you are. I love that you got that. Decides she's going to blow up the retreating spaceship. She uses Torchwood. Ooh, what's Torchwood? Find out later in the week. To blow up this spaceship, and I tell her chief of staff, I whisper in his ear, don't you think she looks tired? And I bring down the government, because that's what the doctor does. Sometimes we need a doctor in our lives, don't we? I don't mean the current government. I mean what's terrifyingly rumbling down the track. No, it's not going to happen. It's going to be fine. Not for me to say. I don't live here. Please do the right thing. The rest of the world is really scared, that's all. You probably know that. Sorry, where were we? Yes, it's that scene anyway. You all knew that, fine.
But it must have been surreal for that little three-year-old boy.
Bananas.
Being on the set.
Bananas, yeah.
Like, seeing all that stuff, seeing, you know.
Walking out the TARDIS. Like you own it, and you do. Yeah. Insane.
You made your directorial debut on the 2007 Doctor Who Confidential episode. What was that experience like, and do you like directing?
You have researched this. I was credited as a director, but it was a documentary, so it was more to do with the concept and sort of leading the story of what that was. This was like a half-hour documentary show that went, again, I don't know if everyone knows this. You do know, well, Doctor Who used to have a little half-hour documentary that I went with it every week, and I took one of the episodes and sort of made it, and it was about sort of people who grew up loving Doctor Who and ended up working on Doctor Who. That's, you know, I felt I was qualified to do that. And I spoke to Russell D. Davis and I spoke to Stephen Moffat, and I asked him if he wanted to take over, and he didn't reply. I loved doing that because it was a world that, you know, I had a lot to say about, and I felt like I had a particular vantage point to talk about it from. So it was fun, yeah, you know, but it was a very particular thing. I don't know that would really translate to directing other things. I sort of toy with the idea of directing. I'd like to try it, but I don't know what it would be. I've had a couple of sort of false starts with directing things that for various reasons haven't worked out. I don't know. I don't know if I could do it or not. I suspect I probably need to try it at some point.
You should.
Well.
That was great. That episode was great. You directed that episode.
Well. directed, turned up, I don't know.
It's the same thing.
It's the same thing.
Thank you.
Some of them don't even turn up, so.
Tell me about filming the 50th anniversary special with all the other Doctor Whos.
Yeah. It was really good fun. It was scary because it was going back to something that had been a huge part of my life, and then I decided to move on from, and that was a wrench, and it was the right thing to do. And then of course they ask you back, and you can go, it was always fun, but maybe it won't be fun anymore. And it's not my show anymore, and I don't want to tread on Matt Smith's toes. I didn't really know him that well, and how would that be? And how would it be to sort of share the TARDIS? How would that feel? And of course, Matt thought it was a great idea too, so we just ended up having a really good time. It was really, really good fun, I have to say.
And all the other Doctor Whos that were there.
Well, there was only really Matt, and then John Hurt, who hadn't been a Doctor until then, but suddenly became one. and thank goodness he did. Yeah. But it was more, Matt and I didn't really feel on a level with John Hurt. We would sort of sit around him like that. And we'd look at him, and he'd tell stories, and Matt and I would look at each other going, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Tell us about the Beatles, John. And he would. He's just amazing, isn't he?
Yeah.
And really good fun, and really kind of was just thrilled to be there. And we're just having a lark. Yeah. It was great.
That was a great special. During the middle of your Whomania blitz, you electrified audiences as Hamlet for the RSC. Which was also filmed for the BBC. I know a lot of you saw that.
Also available on DVD.
Also available on DVD. Go to Amazon. What was it like taking on that role?
It was just, again, I didn't really think it through, if I'm honest. I'd always wanted to do it. It's one of those, you know, I can't speak for all actors, but many actors, I suppose, it feels like it's kind of, it's the Olympic event, isn't it? It's the marathon. It's the thing against which, if you're allowed the opportunity, you can kind of test yourself. It's a fucking good part, and it has. You know, you can't avoid the fact that it has a sort of mystique about it. So to be asked to do it at all feels like an honour, and then to get to do it with the Royal Shakespeare Company, you think, well, I can't say no to this, even if I wanted to. And it sort of just sort of happened. And there's a weird sort of story where I was doing a show about my family tree for the BBC called Who Do You Think You Are? You've seen that too, wow. Yeah, which is a great show and was a real privilege to do. And I so happened to be in an old church in Ireland. It's a Scotland. Sorry, there was an Irish bit and there was a Scottish bit. And there were skulls in this church, and I picked one up and looked at it. And Greg Doran apparently was watching the TV and thought that was a good idea. So it was just a sort of meeting of moments, and it so happened that Doctor Who was having a slightly longer hiatus that year because of the way we were going to do some specials rather than a whole other series. There was a gap, it fitted in. It was just one of those things that just kind of all the moons met. And you kind of go, yeah, of course I want to do Hamlet for the Royal Shakespeare Company. Of course I do. You'd say that a year before you start rehearsals. And then the day you start rehearsals, oh my God, the terror, you know. Because you suddenly go, I've got to actually do this now. I've got 6 weeks to rehearse this and not make an arse of myself. And it was wonderful. It was one of the most formative experiences of my life, without a doubt. It's such an extraordinary, there is no other part like it. There just isn't. That's why it's got the mystique about it. There's everything in it. And it's massive, and you have to start every day by doing a sword fight rehearsal, and you have to go straight from that to rehearsing talking about the death of your parents and then fighting with your mother, and it got everything. And because it's got everything, and because I was doing Doctor Who at the time, which elicited a degree of scrutiny all of its own, I didn't really think about the two things meeting and the amount of hoo-ha that it would cause. And, you know, when it comes to first night, you're scared enough. But then when the BBC roll up outside to report on it, you go, what? I'm doing a play and just leave me alone. And suddenly you go, oh God, if I'm bad in this, that would be awful on a personal level anyway, if I didn't manage to climb this mountain. But they're gonna tell everyone around the world that I'm bad in it as well. Live on News 24. So it was excruciating and magnificent. It was sort of one of those experiences that was unlike maybe anything else. Every night was a kind of shitstorm in my head, because that's the play, and because that's the kind of mountain of it, and because of the amount of attention it was getting. It was sort of bonkers. It was absolutely bonkers, and I was more tired than I've ever been. I was more invigorated than I've ever been, but I was scared every night. I was really, really scared. But every night I kind of thought, oh, I can't do it again. I can't do it again. And yet it just sort of takes you. It's one of those. It's a wonderful thing. And then as soon as it finished, you kind of you were sort of desperate for it to finish, because it was sort of killing me. And then the minute it's finished, you're going to go, oh, I might have to do that again. And then we got to revisit it to film it, which was a wonderful thing, because that felt like we could kind of keep it forever somehow.
The close-ups. If you haven't seen this Hamlet, I know some of you have. I see you out there in the audience. The scenes, how Gregory shot the film, and you just live in those moments so beautifully.
It's such a privilege to get to something, to get to do 100 odd shows of it, or whatever it was we did. So you know it backwards, and then you get to film it. That's what filming should always be. You should do 100 performances of everything, and then get to film it. Don't you think?
Yeah.
I think SAG-AFTRA should make that a rule. Can we put that? Can we enforce that as a union?
Do it on stage first.
Yeah, because then you all the sort of stuff that is usually roaring in your head when you're filming something is removed. And actually, you know it. You know that you understand the journey. You know what the thought processes are. And it's all just about finding the sort of truth into the camera in that little moment.
Yeah.
It was a wonderful opportunity to get to do that, yeah.
Beautifully done. Do you have a ritual before you go on stage? Does it change before each show? Or what's like the last thing you do before you go on as Richard II?
Check my hair.
It's great hair.
It is great hair, but it needs a lot of maintenance. The last thing I do is put the crown on.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the very last thing I do. Or pick the scepter up. That's probably the last thing I do. But I don't really have rituals. I'm sort of anti-superstitious.
Okay.
I'm happy to say Macbeth as many times as you like. If people don't like it, I find it really hard not to start quoting from the play. But I don't. I'm respectful-ish. I'm quite proud of the fact that I have no rituals and I have no superstitions, except of course I do. Like I every show I do has to have a soundtrack. I have to have the same album playing. And for this, of course, it's the same album that I was playing in 2013 because it's the same production. So it's David Bowie, but not the last album, the one before. That's my Richard II album.
Yeah.
For Hamlet, it was a Coldplay album. For Much Ado About Nothing, it was a Las Vegas album. It's slightly random how they get selected, but once they're in there, they are in there, and they are locked in. So yeah, I'm as superstitious as everyone else. That's what it turns. And my lack of superstition is a superstition in itself. Because of course you start, because it's all it's such a stupid thing to do, isn't it? Yeah. Walk out in front of people wearing silly clothes and recite a scheme of lines that you've learned with your friends who are all doing the same thing. Sometimes you can look around and go, this is really silly. We've all put lots of silly costumes on and we're on stage kind of shouting at each other. And I'm going to say this because then I know you can say that, thank you, and then I'll say that. If you break it down, it's so daft.
Yeah.
But you have to sort of surround yourself with a bit of magic, don't you? A bit of something, just to kind of convince yourself it's important.
I love it.
Oh, I'm going to take my equity card away now. But I think that's sort of what I think that's what it's about, isn't it? That's the kind of balance, isn't it? We all know it's a bit silly, don't we? But it's so important when you're, you know, and you want to do it. All that matters is doing it well and being okay and getting through it and telling a story and it's having those two things going on at the same time. Because that's sort of it strikes me that's what acting is. You kind of, on one hand, you're in this kind of imaginative construct that you're continually kind of reappraising and adjusting and you're in that world and you're having this journey. At the same time, you know exactly what's going to happen next, and you know where you're supposed to stand to say it, and you know when you put that costume on, and that's all so artificial. And yet, at the same time, you're balancing it with this thing, which is this imaginative leap. It doesn't really make sense, and it's all a bit sort of you kind of can't examine it too much, or it falls apart.
Yeah.
Which is why you end up having little rituals and having sort of because it's about sort of spinning plates and not looking at them. It's about sort of doing that, isn't it? I don't know. I'm trying to come up with
but it's
a philosophy of acting live in front of a room full of people. That's a bad idea. Think about it first before you open your mouth. Maybe write it down. Maybe figure out if it works before you start extemporizing in front of people. Don't give them your inner monologue while you're sitting in front of them. Don't do that.
It's finding that balance.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Of all the things you have to do, you know, to be on stage like that.
Yeah.
Where am I going? Oh, working with Patrick Stewart. What was that like?
Terrible. No, I mean, he's just a joy. He's great. And that was another thing about making that made Hamlet terrifying. Patrick Stewart's always wanted to play Claudius. Yeah. He wants to play it because he was in a company and he saw it being played, but he has to play it as the ghost as well. That's how he sees it. This is all coming from Greg. So I'm thinking, oh, that's nice. So Patrick Stewart's going to be Claudius to your Hamlet. What? Well, Patrick Stewart, who kind of can open a show on Broadway on his own, wants to come and play Claudius in Hamlet with me. Yeah. Okay, great. I mean, obviously, great. But at the same time, it just meant the whole thing. There was a fire under it from the off. But he couldn't. I mean, he's a company member.
Oh, yes.
He's not. He obviously he's a massive star. Yeah. But that's not how he operates. He's he wants to come to Stratford to do a play because he's got a burning ambition to do it, and he's great at it, and he's a joy to be around, and he's I loved working with him, and I loved that he was part of that company, and I am and continue to be in awe of him and all that he does.
Yeah, I had both Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen here for this series.
Yeah, both very difficult. Very difficult.
And we spoke about.
I just did a radio play with Ian McKellen. There's another one. Oh. I just did Look Back in Anger, which is another play I did when I was almost not too old for it. I've just done it for Radio 4 when I'm far too old for it. But it's on the radio, so it doesn't matter. Because it's the 60th anniversary of Look Back in Anger this year, and nobody was doing it. So for the first time in my life, I phoned up Radio 4 and went, you should do Look Back in Anger. And they went, okay. And Richard Wilson is directing it, which it was a wonderful treat that Richard. So he just phones up his mate, Ian McKellen, and says, will you come and do, like, it's like 4 pages. Will you come in and do that? And he said, yes. Which is kind of, I think it's, the fact that I think that shows that Patrick and Ian are proper company actors because they're interested in doing something because they're interested in doing it and because so it's not about them. That's fine.
They are the nicest. They were here for this series and we talked about major acting
and
breakthroughs.
How much do they love each other?
Oh, it's like
get a room.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's lovely though, yeah.
Well, we talked about major acting breakthroughs throughout one's career.
Oh, yeah.
And Ian said that when he, for his biggest breakthrough was when he came out as a gay man, he said it unlocked everything for him and freed him of everything.
Should I do that now?
Yes.
Okay.
Do it tonight. Patrick used to wear hair pieces and everything else and comb his hair over, and his friends shaved his head at their house, at their flat.
Wow.
And Patrick said the night that happened freed me, because he always felt he was hiding behind something.
Right, right.
So I was wondering, was there ever a major acting breakthrough at some point during your career that you can talk about that moved you from like 100 to 1,000 or just shifted it somewhere else?
Again, like we said earlier, it's hard to note them objectively. I don't have a moment like my baldy head or my coming out. But I'm going to work on that. I'm going to find one. Might be the making of me. But I suppose looking back on it with a bit of distance, taking over the asylum certainly changed things professionally.
Yeah.
And then Doctor Who did as well because it turned me from someone who was known within the industry to someone who was known in the world, and that has good and bad bits to it, without a doubt. But it still opened more doors than it's closed for me, and I'll be forever grateful for that.
Sure. After something as iconic as Doctor Who that catapults you into pop culture superstardom, how do you put that kind of success into perspective and yet stay so grounded?
Oh, wow. This is where I tell you about having all the blue M&Ms removed. I don't know. I don't know. I mean, because it's all, there's what you do at work and then there's who you are.
Yeah.
I mean, they're they can't be too linked. I mean, they are, because what you do at work is we are our own sort of, we're all we've got, aren't we? You turn up at work, you don't have to bring anything, really. You just turn up and you're ready to go. Where am I going with this? I don't know. I hope I've remained grounded.
Oh, you have?
Well, You sounded slightly disappointed in me there. I just think there are... I've got to do a thing at my old drama school this summer. And they've asked me to speak for 5 minutes. I've always said no to things like that because I don't know where to start. I don't know how you turn up and go, right, let me be sage and let me tell you. I don't know what to say. And I thought, people always say, what advice have you got to actors? I don't have any. I genuinely don't have any. I don't know. I don't know how it works. Doesn't make any sense. Good luck. SAG are really pleased they asked me to come here. But I sort of have got to do this like little 5-minute address in the summer. I thought, what am I going to say? So I thought, I better start thinking about this. And I thought, there are only three things that I know is good advice. Everyone's gone really hushed. They're not that interesting, and they're not that insightful. But they are the three things that I think, the only three things you really need to do to be an actor. Turn up on time. That got a groan? Who's like, no, come late. Keep them waiting, they love it. Turn up on time, learn your lines, and be nice. Yep. I just think that's all, that's it. And I've literally got nothing else. How do I stretch that into 5 minutes?
Just say that, that's amazing, but just say that.
But I do think there are too many of us, and there's no excuse for being an arsehole. I just think it makes my skin crawl. That's not me being terribly sanctimonious. I can't do it. If I sort of get into a bit of an argy-bargy or a bit of an argument, the day's ruined for me. I can't do the conflict. And I see that some people can. I see that some people sort of live off it. But it scares me. I get hyperventilating. I can go, please be nice to that runner. Oh my God, they brought you coffee. Be nice. I just don't, there's too many of us. You know, we are very well looked after. When we are at work, we're very well looked after. Yeah. We are indulged. There are all sorts of arguments as to why that should be the case, but just be nice about it. Yeah. And I think I just think that's a rule for living. I mean, I don't think that's a rule for being an actor. That's just a rule for being alive and being a member of the human race. And that, I don't see why that shouldn't translate onto a set or into a theater company. So it's just, and that's just my own, that's my own insecurity. I can't bear it when people start being minty. If I have remained grounded, it's because I'm far too afraid to be anything else.
Got it, perfect. But that's great advice, give that. Three of the best things.
But it's not 5 minutes. It'll take me like 30 seconds.
Show a clip.
Yes.
Bring Richard a second, bring Hamlet.
Three bits of advice and now a retrospective of my life.
Out of my career. Well, you were also a part of the Harry Potter family when you played Barty Crouch Jr. in Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire.
Yeah.
Fondest memories of working on that film. And did they just give it to you?
No. I was doing a show called The Pillow Man.
Okay, yeah.
The National Theatre.
Oh, yeah.
Quite a good play. And Mike Newell came to see it, and that's why I got that part. I had to go and meet him and talk to him, but he's old school film director, so he doesn't want you to audition. He just wants to know. He just wants to look you in the eye and see you're a hail fellow well met. You can have the part. It's all that. it was. I think the memories of that have got to be the company you keep. I mean, you sit off set, and it's just the best green room there's ever been. Michael Gambon, who is the funniest man alive, in this ridiculous beard, which he has a little sack for. He does. And he comes off set, and someone comes with his little sack. And they tie
it up.
So he sits with his big beard. But I was a junior member of the company. So they all had chairs like this with their name on the back. And I had a chair like that. So I was in a scene with Maggie, with Michael, with Alan Rickman, God bless him, obviously with Daniel, with Timothy Spall. I was in a scene with all these big high Hegians, and then they'd bring my little chair like that. And in my scene, I was the only one with the little chair. They just had cast written on the back. But I wasn't going to, so there was something mildly humiliating there. But I wasn't going to miss out. So there'd be this circle of these chairs, they're all like that. And I'd be like that. But it was such good fun because, I mean, Maggie Smith in a witch's hat is already funny. And when she starts going, oh, darling, look at this. I mean, just bliss, just bliss to be in that company and to be watching those people doing what they do and to be sort of a sightseer, you know. It's just, it was a hoot.
Were you able to keep your little cast chair?
I didn't know. No, are you kidding? That was used for someone else in the next minute. No, I mean, I did like 12 days on that film over a year. It shot for a year. And I was there for 12 days. But it casts a long shadow. People love those movies.
Sure.
And it was wonderful. Mike Newell was brilliant. I loved him. Yeah. Never asked me to do anything else. Michael, I'm available.
You're
all close up.
Totally. You're also well known to legions of fans as Detective Alec Hardy on the critically acclaimed BBC crime series Broadchurch.
Thank you.
What attracted you to that?
Do you know it's not a BBC series?
It's not.
Everyone in America thinks it's a BBC series because it plays on BBC America. Yeah. It's an ITV series.
Oh, ITV series, Broadchurch.
It has commercial breaks. But then BBC America would show it over here. So
that's a weekend. Yeah.
Yeah.
What attracted you? Was it the role? Was it the story?
It was, well, it came to me through people that I knew. Chris Chibnall, the writer I'd worked with on Doctor Who, and I'd worked with on a TV movie called United, about the Manchester United Munich air crash.
Yeah.
A brilliant piece of writing. And James Strong, a director I'd worked with on Doctor Who. And again on United. We'd all work together again on United. So they approached me, really. And I thought, well, if Chris and James are doing it, then I should probably look at this. And then Olivia Colman was cast, at which point you're going to go, oh, okay, I'll look at this. And you read that first script and you're going to go, oh, yes, yeah, sure, this is great. So it was the people involved and then of course it's the script, yeah.
Now you begin you start filming season three.
Season three, as soon as I finish here, yeah.
Tonight.
Yeah. I mean, in New York, generally. Yeah.
Can you tell us anything?
No, I don't know anything. I don't know, which is sort of easier, because then you don't have to lie about not knowing anything. That's not true. I know very vague things, which I'm not going to tell you. But I know I'm in it. I know Olivia Colman's in it. I know Jodie Whittaker and Andy Buchan are in it. Oh, maybe that's not been announced. Has that been announced? That might have been announced. I didn't see anything. And some other people are in it. Okay. And that's about as much as I know.
But you love playing this man, don't you?
It's great, yeah. I love that journey that he's gone on. I love the scripts that Chris writes. I love working with Olivia and the cast. It's a fun job, considering the darkness of the material, but we have a really good time doing it. And it's exciting because we get the scripts as we go, so we don't know where it's going, particularly in that first series, which was a whodunit. We didn't know until episode 8 got delivered. Whodunit. So you're doing all these scenes as a police officer and you're interrogating these people and you genuinely don't know if they're lying. Which is great, you know.
It's better that way sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
Especially during interviews.
I thought everyone was guilty. Which kind of played for the character quite well. Olivia thought everyone was innocent. We would be talking about these we'd be offset talking like our characters. I'm going, definitely did it. He definitely did it. And he knows. I know we've not had the scripts, but he knows, and he knows he did it. Chris has told him. I think he's overplaying it, to be honest. I think he wants to dial that back, because the audience are going to get it. She's going, I don't think so. I don't think so. So anyway, we reverted to form, I think, on that.
I love it. This past November, you starred as the villainous Dr. Zebediah Kilgrave, otherwise known as the Purple Man.
Yeah.
Opposite Krystin Ritter in the Netflix Marvel series, Jessica Jones. I love Netflix because you can actually sit there and you can watch the whole series.
Absolutely.
You start at 8 o'clock at night and you say, I'm gonna watch two episodes. And then at Netflix, it's like, your next episode starts in 4 seconds. You're like, I'll watch one more.
Yeah, watch. One more can't hurt.
And then the sun comes up and you're like, yeah. Oh my God, I'm done.
Yeah.
I know you've been a Marvel comic fan your whole entire life. So how much fun was this working on this?
Oh, it's great fun. Great fun because again, it was obviously inspired by Marvel comics. Not Marvel comics that I knew. It's not one of the kind of marquee characters. It can do it. I mean, Jessica Jones? Is she Spider-Woman? No, that's Jessica. That's a different Jessica. So I had to seek it out. If you've not read the original source material comic book, it's fantastic. By Brian Michael Bendis and Michael Gaidos. It's brilliant. So I read this thinking, this is gonna, and it's already a TV series, you know, and initially it's really quite loyal to that source material, and the scripts were great, and this extraordinary character who's got so much going on, who's got the most extraordinary superpower there's ever been, and chooses it to use it just to have a really good time. It's brilliant. What a brilliant concept, because of course he could be taking over the world and he could be, but it would sort of be too, I don't know where you'd go with that story. It's just great that he's so petty and he's so petulant. And there's quite a lot of Richard II going on there. There's quite a lot of parallels.
Yeah.
The entitlement, the sort of bubble of acquiescence that they live within. It was just a great character and a story really well told. I think Melissa Rosenberg, our showrunner, and her team of writers were really exceptional. Krystin was brilliant casting. Yeah. Mike Coulter's Luke Cage is brilliant casting. It was one of those projects that just all came together. And yes, to be working for Marvel was a hoot. I got shown around Marvel Comics. And they're all Doctor Who fans, so they all thought I was great. And I was thinking, but I think you're great. This is brilliant.
Yeah. Were you happy that they didn't make you totally purple?
Yes, I think ultimately I was. I think after the first week, that would have gotten old.
Yeah.
Turning up in makeup 4 hours before everyone else. But I think it was the right decision. I think that's I think Marvel are very clever, the way they've brought the comic book world into the live action world. I think they've done it really, they've nuanced it really well. And I think that's the kind of decision that they've got right. Because it would, especially in this particular kind of Netflix world of shows, which are the same show as The Avengers and Guardians of the Galaxy, but they're a kind of gritty little armpit of it. You know, they're sort of, they're a bit stenchy and they're a bit filthy and they're a bit grown up. And I think it was right that, because that's quite, the Kilgrave's power is quite out there in that world as they've been, you know, the Daredevil world, it's very real world. And it just moved that little bit spicier with something like Kilgrave's power. And I think it was right to just keep it grounded and keep it real. And I feel very lucky to have been part of that, yeah.
Growing up, loving Marvel comics and all of this stuff, did it make it easier for you to play a villain, like out of those comics? Because you live in that world so well.
Oh, well, thank you.
Right, don't you agree? Does he live in that world well?
I don't know. I suppose growing up with comic books would inspire your imagination in a certain way, and I'm sure that's informed everything that I've done. You know, in the same way that growing up going to the theater does it. Whatever your influences are, that you can't really sort of start sifting them out. So those influences will be in me when I do Broadchurch or Richard II, the same way as I do something like Kilgrave. And I can't sort of unpick that really. You know, you just get a script and you try and tell the story. That's what you're employed to do, and that's what you do. And be on time and learn your lines. Be nice.
That's
and,
it.
I don't know. I can't unpick that, I suppose.
Got it. You're also an award-winning voiceover actor. You've done lending your talent to such projects as How to Train Your Dragon, Star Wars, The Clone Wars, and Tree Fu Tom. Do you enjoy the process of that, sitting in a booth with headphones on?
I love it. Yeah, it's great fun. Because you get to do such extraordinary things. I got to play a droid Jedi master. You know, And I was in a booth in London, and they're in LA, and we're kind of going, oh, should we do one more? Yeah. You know, it's such a mad thing to do. And then it comes on telly, and you're a little animated sprite. It's great. No, I'm loving all that, and I've got a really exciting one coming, but I'm not allowed, I don't think I could say.
It just stays here.
Yeah. No, I'm really excited. I've just done the first few episodes of a kid's new animated show. That's a kind of pretty iconic character. I'm really quite pleased with myself. You'll find out. No, I loved doing all that stuff.
Because I've spoken to a lot of actors here, like they're in a booth in London, like you said, and the director's in California on Skype or on a headset saying, well, just do it a little funnier or just, you know, one more take.
Yeah. And you can sort of never be too over the top doing things like that, which suits my personality.
Totally.
They're very tiring, though. I tend to come out very sweaty from those kind of sessions. I do jump about a lot. But no, it's great fun, yeah.
Some of your other memorable stage performances have been in Martin McDonagh's The Pillow Man and Kenneth Lonergan's Lobby Hero. What made these so special for you? I know you love these two playwrights.
I do. Well, they're just great bits of writing.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing. And they're both fantastic characters. Jeff in Lobby Hero. I saw Kenny Lonergan last night. I hadn't seen him in like 14 years. And he came to Richard II. I was so touched. And he was... It brought back so many happy memories of that show. That's just it's one of those gifts. I don't know if you know the play, but it's just, he talks in this kind of stream of consciousness and he goes back in himself and it's funny. It's such a funny play and he's such a funny character and he's dysfunctional. He's a bit rubbish and he's a bit, he sort of has self-loathing, but he's also quite pleased with himself. And it's just one of those characters that you just love. It was such a treat to get to do that. And Pillow Man is just this weird, dark, messed up, the inside of Martin McDonagh's head. He's such a weird sewer of a place, but it's such glorious stuff. And Pillow Man was a great experience because of the other three guys that I did it with who we had such a fantastic time doing that show. And it was one of those shows that the audiences just adored, and critics didn't get, which is funny looking back now, because they ultimately gave it all these prizes, and it transferred, and it's going to be revived, and you look back, and they all went, this play doesn't really work, and now they all go, I didn't say that, but it was one of those things that made it all the more special, because the audience discovered it and kind of disagreed with the critics, and it became a sort of phenomenon, It's a great play.
They're both incredible writers.
Great writers. Yes. That's what you need. I mean, you know, that's you can make, you can fuck up a good bit of writing, but you can't make a bad bit of writing good. Yeah. Really, you can sort of dust it a little bit and put a few sparkles on, but it's got to start with the writing, and then it's your job not to mess it up. Those are the sort of experiences you hope for.
Sure. Up next for you is starring alongside Elizabeth Moss in the film Mad to Be Normal.
Yeah.
Who do you play and what can you tell us about the film?
We've shot it already. I play Ronnie Lang, R.D. Lang, who was a psychotherapist and psychoanalyst. And how to describe him? I mean, he was a psychiatric doctor. He came up through the National Health Service in the 50s, and he saw people having electroconvulsive therapy given to them as a sort of matter of course, being prescribed pills that deadened them. And he sort of, his life's work was kind of about challenging that and challenging the status quo within mental health treatment. And famously, and what the film really concerns is he set up a kind of commune in Kingsley Hall in the East End of London. And for about 5 years, he ran this sort of, a commune where he himself and some other doctors lived with some patients who had very serious psychiatric problems, and they all just lived together. And there was no medication. And whatever people wanted to do, they were allowed to do. And it was this idea that you sort of follow the illness. And it was hugely controversial then. It's still controversial now. Quite what he proved and what changed is difficult to ascertain. But what he started is a debate about how we treat the mentally ill.
Yeah.
And he changed thinking. He didn't necessarily change the therapies. ECT is still used. In fact, it's making a sort of slightly weird comeback. And to be fair, some people absolutely swear by it and say that it's important and that it's helped them. So I'm not debunking it. But he just challenged this. He started people thinking about people suffering from mental illness as human beings rather than as things that needed to be treated. That you don't treat a mental illness in the same way as you treat a dodgy knee.
Yeah.
That it's a different type of way of thinking. It's also about who he was, and he was a complicated man, and he was, as I understand, quite a difficult man, and the film addresses all that, and it's based on some things that happened, but there's most of the characters, because you're dealing with a lot of real people who had real mental issues. It's a sort of fictionalized account of what happened within Kingsley Hall. So Lizzie Moss plays, doesn't play a real character, but she plays the woman in RD's life at that time. And we had Michael Gambon, yeah. There's an amazing scene where we're having a therapy session. Look out for it, it's wonderful. And Gabriel Byrne plays a very damaged individual, and it's fantastic. Hopefully, I mean, I don't know. It's in the edit suite just now. Let's hope it all works. It was an exciting film to get to make, because that's the kind of film that's difficult to get funded.
Yeah,
that's there's nothing very sexy about mental illness. Finn Glynn, our producer, did an extraordinary job in getting the funding on that together. You know, putting together an independent film is never easy, and these days, sort of television is kind of occupying that place, which is wonderful. It means we get all this great TV, but it does mean small independent art house films are really tough to get off the ground. And Finn did an extraordinary job in holding that together.
How long was the shoot for you?
4.5 weeks. It was tough and it was tight.
Yeah.
And it was, all the time you're chasing you're chasing budget and but the fact that you had the actors that you had all signing up for it. I think it's a story that it needs to be told.
Yeah. We're going to wrap this up soon, but I have one or two questions quickly from the audience. Someone wrote, would you ever do a Broadway musical?
If I could sing? I don't know. I like the idea of doing it. And I can sort of sing. I mean, I'm not a singer. I can sort of bang out a tune, but I can sort of already go in and say, he's a serviceable singer. I can hear those. I don't know. The trouble with things like that is they ask for huge commitments of time a long way in advance, and I always find that quite hard to juggle. And I have a family, and would we all move to New York or I don't know. There are sort of problems about it, but I love the idea of doing that. Yeah. I just don't know how it would work in practice.
Got it. Is there another Shakespeare role you'd still like to play?
Oh yeah, loads. Long, ever-growing list. Yeah.
Who would you like to tackle next, do you think?
Oh, I'd love to do Iago. I'd love to do. Yeah. I'd love to do Malvolio. I'd quite like to do Bottom. I've discovered recently.
Interesting. Yeah.
Not obvious casting. But I'd quite like to do that. I'd like to do Angelo in Measure for Measure. I think is a glorious play. Oh, there's loads of them. Yeah.
One quick thing. During your run here at BAM with Richard II, you'll be returning to Stratford upon Avon to host Shakespeare Live from the RSC on April 23rd.
I know. Crazy air miles, huh?
So, I mean, not only is he doing Richard II here, you're going to fly over there. Everyone's
like
in this.
I'm Phil Collins in Live Aid, aren't I?
For Shakespeare, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So Judi Dench, Ian McKellen, everyone's a part of
and
this,
you
right?
You don't even know the people they haven't announced yet. It's going to be great.
Oh. And you'll be hosting the night. Then you fly back?
Yeah. Yes.
Then you'll fly back here.
I'll fly back and do another couple of Richard II's, yeah.
So everyone in the world, Gregory Doran and the company of the RSC, has put together this evening, which will be shot live that night.
We broadcast live from the Royal Shakespeare Theatre on the BBC, and then they're doing one of those cinema relays, like one of those live from Stratford, National Theatre Live type things. So I think that probably, I guess it would be the next day here, I would have thought.
Which we're going to get here. So look online to, you know, get tickets for that. My final question for you is, what is the best bit of advice that you've been given, either personally and professionally, that you live by?
I don't know the answer to that. I mean, I'm sure there are lots, but I can't think of one sort of headline, really. Just be nice, say thank you, be a human being. I don't know. Richard Wilson, it was interesting working with Richard Wilson early on. As I say, he was and still is an enormous star in Great Britain. And he became a great friend, and he still is. He never offered advice, but I just saw how you could be in the public eye and be absolutely gracious and be handle that beautifully, be appropriate, give sort of people what they were hoping for when they met you, and still maintain your own life and be your own person. And Richard didn't sort of give me a spreadsheet on how to do that, but I think observing him was something, when something like Doctor Who then hit years later and suddenly you have that thing and you can't go to the supermarket without people wanting to take your picture, and that's quite weird when that first happens, because you don't really, there aren't classes on that in drama school. There probably should be.
Yeah.
I mean, it might not apply to everyone, but it's because you can't see it coming, and who knows when it's going to come, and it can happen, if it does happen, so quite unexpectedly, and that's quite difficult to deal with, actually, and because you sort of lose a bit of yourself, it gets kind of taken away and appropriated. So I was just watching how Richard handled that was very formative, and I continue to look to him for advice on many things.
That could be part of your 5 minutes for your speech.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but I'd be talking to drama students, and they all think they're about to become the most famous people on earth, because that's what you do when you're a drama student, and quite right and proper. Because if you can't think it then, yeah, then you really don't have any hope. So yeah, maybe though. Maybe I'll say that. Maybe I'll get Richard to come with me.
Totally, get him to come.
Yeah, he'd make much more sense than I would.
Listen, I want to thank you for one of the best nights. I've been doing this for a long time. This was really,
was
really
it the
special.
Best?
This was the best, right?
Yeah. But can I tell Patrick, can I text Patrick Stewart and tell him mine was better than his? Oh, now you're getting scared.
Now I'm getting scared.
Yeah. I'm going to do it anyway.
Do it anyway. No, but thank you on your night off from Richard II.
Thank
if you
so
haven't
much.
Seen that, try to get a ticket. Thank you from the bottom of my heart, my friend.
Thank you very much.
The best. Thank David you. Tennant.
Thanks very much. Cheers.